screen, set my right, goes to the left, gets into length, scoops it up.
Oh, my goodness.
And Council off the glass finally puts the Friars on the board.
That's the best move we've seen all year. That was ridiculous. I don't even know how he got that shot off.
Joe's right. I don't know how he got that shot off, but Vincent Council with some, what we call sometimes French pastry, with some of the fancy moves, getting into the lane and getting into the basket, and did a superb job last night. In fact, there were several great individual plays that the Friars had last night. It's just, of course, unfortunate they couldn't sustain it. Hey, Friar fans, best way to guarantee your seat for the PC Connecticut game coming up on January the 27th or the PC Syracuse game on February 23rd is to purchase a mini plan package. You can choose either Connecticut or Syracuse and two other games to create your own package. Packages are as low as just $30. Available now by calling 401-865-GO-PC. Welcome back to the Keno Davis Radio Show. I'm John Rook. Again, we're at Twist Restaurant here until 8 o'clock. We're at 336 Bald Hill Road in Warwick. And if you come on out, you'll have a chance to register for tickets to see the Friars and win some tickets, see the Friars take on Rutgers this Saturday night in the Dunkin' Donuts Center. Coach, I wanted to take a couple of minutes just to kind of hit around the Big East Conference and then want to deal with some of the names that Friar fans will undoubtedly become a lot more familiar with over the course of the next, well, we hope 4 years anyway. First of all, within the league, West Virginia, Louisville, Villanova, all unbeaten in Big East play. They won last night. Georgetown fell from the ranks of the unbeaten. They lost at Marquette. You've got to go play at Marquette in another, 10 days or so. You know, Marquette's one of those teams, though, that wasn't thought of a lot early in the season, yet they seem to have a lot of what I would call stick-to-itiveness. They're very tough, and they look to be very difficult to kind of game plan for.
Well, I think also what you're looking at is a team that, you know, was with before they had an injury last year, Dominic James, I believe. You know, they were as good as anybody in the conference. They were a top three or four team, and everybody knows we had three number one seeds in there. So they were very tough, and so they had some good players off the bench, some guys that weren't getting minutes, and they were able to, you know, come back, and they've been very talented and tough this year. It's going to be difficult for us to go on the road. Our next three road games, when you talk about DePaul, Marquette, Cincinnati, those three teams have 8 days, 8 days, and 6 days in between games right before we play them. So the scheduling did not.
You need me to talk to the schedule maker at the Big East Conference for you? Would that help?
The scheduling did not favor us in those three games coming in. It's nice to be able to have a week to prepare for those teams for us coming in, especially that we play a little different than a lot of the teams in the conference. But I think we're going to go in there on the road with kind of a nothing-to-lose attitude and see how hard we can play. And no, yay, we're not going to get all the road games, but if we can play like we did at St. John's with that kind of intensity and keep improving, we're going to get our opportunities.
One thing's for certain, the road shouldn't scare your guys anymore. They've experienced success. They've tasted it. They know what it takes now.
Well, and, you know, tasting success at St. John's, obviously, I mean, they're talented. But when we try to develop our program, there's so many areas that we have to move forward in. Obviously, you know, in recruiting and talent and scheduling and fundraising. But also, you know, when you look at our crowd and trying to get the energy level up, the teams at the top of the league, Louisville's crowd, West Virginia's crowd, Villanova's crowd, we've got to be able to get the intensity up, you know, in the dunk. And it just isn't where it needs to be. And it's not a crutch of saying, you know, that's why we're not winning. But everything has to move forward. So when we look next year and you talk about our crowd and our energy level and how loud it gets in there, it's got to be better than this year or we're not moving forward. And so that's going to be kind of, you know, my mindset in that every year we have to move forward in all these areas. And when we do, they'll all come together and we'll have some great years.
By the way, Marquette's three Big East games have each been decided by a combined 5 points. Right, so they've all been decided by 5 points, a combined 5 points. So looks like Marquette's learning how to win the close ones as well.
Well, you know, they had West Virginia beat on the road, missed free throws down the stretch.
Lost that by two,
and
right.
that's incredible to be able to go down there and almost pull off the win. So you know they're talented and not just play hard. So it'll be a difficult place for us to go, but I think we've seen just about every kind of style of basketball at this point of the year, and so it shouldn't surprise us. Now, can we play at that level that quickly? We'll see.
Well, while we talk about West Virginia and Louisville and Villanova being at one level, Seton Hall is really kind of the hard luck story. Not that anybody is going to lose any sleep over what Seton Hall has gone through, but they're 0-3 in the league after losing last night. Their three losses have been to teams ranked 7, 12, and 13, though, in the country. So pretty tough schedule to start, I think, for Bobby Gonzalez. And if anybody has a right to gripe about the way his schedule has started, he probably gets the right to gripe a little.
Well, you know, the way it started, and when you think back to last year, what kept Notre Dame from being an NCAA tournament team? They were as high as fourth in the country and didn't go to the NCAA. What kept them out was five straight losses in the middle of conference. That all of a sudden there's going to be a stretch where your schedule is just going to make you shake and say, well, what's going on here? This isn't fair. But everybody's got to go through it. Some teams will go through it at the beginning of the year. Some teams in the middle. Some teams at the end. You know, ours kind of jumps around a little bit in some tough stretches. So we've got to make sure that we lose a tough game to Louisville. We got to let that go. And we got to focus on Rutgers. How hard can we play there? And no, we're not going to go undefeated this year. You know, it's a process for us. So can we let that go and just see how hard we can play? Or else we're not going to move as quickly as we need to.
One other league issue to touch on is the fact that a couple of extra non-conference wins last night. So the Big East's cumulative non-league record, 152 wins, 37 losses. That's a winning percentage of almost 81%. And there's only 7 non-league games remaining in the regular season. Still pretty impressive when you consider that this was thought to be a down league or down year for this league.
Well, it's very impressive, I think, especially for the teams picked, you know, in the second half division, that they have had very good non-conference records. It's also good scheduling. You know, we talked about having 4 non-conference road games this
great
year.
Great non-conference scheduling, cruddy conference scheduling.
No,
right?
No team other than us played more than 2 non-conference road games.
It's true.
So we'll work on our schedule for the future and see that doesn't happen again.
We're going to put that one on the coach.
It's really nice to be able to, you know, build some confidence with your team with some really good tough games in the non-conference, but also to not have to travel a lot in the early part really is it makes you ready for the Big East play. And so that's another area that we're working on for the future. And it's all about working ahead. It's working not just for next year. It's working 3-4 years in advance so that when we get this program moving and we're one of those teams in the top 20-25 each and every year and we're competing for championships, it's not going to be a one-year thing. It's going to be because of the hard work you put 4 or 5 years beforehand in the recruiting, in the scheduling, in the fundraising. All of those things have to come together.
I know that after the George Washington game, you talked about when your team scored 110 points, you're going to go try to use that a little bit maybe on the recruiting trail so you can show kids what kind of basketball, how you want to play, the tempo, the offensive philosophy, all that kind of stuff. And even coming into this week, your team is only sitting in 5th in the Big East in scoring, yet 15th nationally. There's a lot of firepower in this league this year.
Well, there really is. You know, it's hard to believe we're 5th. We went down from 2nd to 5th after that game with
Louisville. But you're still 15th in the nation in scoring.
I think that shows how talented the Big East is with scoring. And I think when you look at us, we play more up-tempo than any team in the Big East. And so to be 5th, how do you play more up-tempo and more fast-breaking than everybody else, and you're not scoring more?
Right.
Well, we're not as talented as some of those teams in the league. We need to increase our talent level. We also need to increase our player development. We've got to have guys that'll come into the gym early and stay late so that they have unbelievable, like they who's the next Ryan Gomes? Who's the guy that's going to be in the NBA that nobody saw coming? Well, that's the exciting part. Who of these freshmen is going to come in as sophomores and you're going to go, wow, did he improve in the offseason? Everybody works hard during the season. Who are the guys in the offseason? I think we've got 2 or 3 that are going to surprise some people for next year.
All right.